These are the frequently asked questions for Algebra 2 for section 9.3, day 1. We started to learn about geometric sequences and how to write those, all trying to figure out how we could go back and look at this first section, section 9.1, a different way because we're learning how to write the formulas. So when we look at these, we're trying to figure out, are they geometric? And then if they are, you know, find that common ratio so we can write the formula for them. So determine whether each sequence is geometric. And if it is, find that common ratio. To do that, we want to see whether or not they multiplied. So we use the inverse operation, which is going to be division. So I'm going to take each of these terms and divide it by the previous term. And we'll see what we get. 4/10, pretty obviously, you know, put that into a calculator, should come out to 0.4. And when you take 0.64 and you divide it by 1.6, it's like 64 being divided by 16, which is 4, but we do have a decimal place. So that comes out to 0.4. And same type of thinking with the 1.6 and the 4, think of it as 16 divided by 4, but with a decimal place. So for all three of these, we saw that they were really multiplying by 4/10 all the way through. So is this geometric? Yes. And the common ratio is what we just found. Again, to find that common ratio, just take any term and divide it by the previous term. And if we want to know if it's geometric, it has to come out the same every single time. So number 13, we want to do that same process. So it'll be negative 2/3. Divided by 2, and I'll just go ahead and do that one right now, because when you divide by 2, you're really going to be multiplying by a 1/2, or you can simply think of that one as negative 2/3 divided into 2. Well, that's going to be a negative 1/3. And then we'd have 2 divided by negative 6, which is a negative 1/3, and then we would have negative 6 divided by 18, which is also, of course, a negative 1/3. So we do have a geometric sequence, and our common ratio is a negative 1/3. So if we take any term and divide it by the previous term, and we come up with a consistent number every time, that's what makes this geometric. Then, number 23 says, find the 8th term of each geometric sequence. And I realize that it's just the 8th term, and yeah, we could do it recursively, but we need the practice here at writing these explicit rules for geometric. So a sub n equals a sub 1 times r to the n minus 1. And the first term here is a 24, and I just have to do a little math to figure out what r is. So I'm going to take negative 6 and divide it by 24, and I only have to do 1 because they did tell me that this was geometric. So that will be a negative 1/4 for r, and then to the n minus 1 power. So there's the rule, and then they asked me to just find the 8th term. So that means I am going to replace n with 8. So what I really need here is to figure out what my negative 1/4 to the 7th power is. And you can just grab a calculator for that one and multiply that times 24. And then I'm going to hit math number 1 for the fraction answer back, and that 8th term will be negative 3/2048. So again, could be done recursively, but in this case I wanted to show you how to get that explicit formula and then use that to find that 8th term. I guess when I make the choice between using recursive and explicit, the choice comes down to how many of them would I really have to do, and I'm only really willing to do recursively 2 or 3 times. I get a little impatient, so I'd probably use explicit after that. Then, let's see, it's going to take a while for me to get to another one I thought you might need from this assignment. I've got to get to 65 here. All right, number 65, determined by inspection. Inspection, the end behavior of the graph. So this is where we are supposed to be able to look at this and know what's going to happen. So the first thing I do is check whether or not it's in standard form, and it is. And this is a cubic. So cubics have that S-shaped or snake-like curve. And then this one has a negative in front. So that means it's going to look like so. And end behavior, remember, is talking about whether or not things are going to go up or down. So as we go to the left, this is going to head up. And as we go to the right, this is going to head down. And let's see if we can find one that says that up there. So rises to the left, falls to the right. That's going to be C. And at this point, if something like that were on the MCAs or the ACTs, you could graph it in your calculator and find that out, find that end behavior as you go through there. 68, write an explicit and a recursive formula for each arithmetic sequence. So 68, they're telling me flat out that this is arithmetic, and I'm going to do the explicit first because, again, you know, as soon as I see that arithmetic, I'm already thinking about that wonderful little formula that I have for this, where I substitute in the first term and the common difference, and they are adding 3 here every time. And then we go ahead and distribute from the right-hand side. And then we simplify. So there's the explicit rule right here. Now, recursive. Recursive is when we use the previous term in our explanation. So recursively, I have to give them a place to start. And I'm going to tell them here that the first term is negative 3. And then to get any term, they're going to have to take the previous term, and because this was arithmetic, they're going to have to add 3. So that's my recursive rule. Again, recursive must use the notation for the previous term. That's a part of being a recursive rule, re meaning to do again, and cursive, write. So we're going to rewrite it as a different formula there. Now 69 says 17, 8, and negative 1. And again, they said it was arithmetic, so a sub n equals a sub 1 times n minus 1 plus n minus 1 times d. And our first term is 17, and then leave the n in there, but look for d. So 17 to 8, 8 to negative 1, they are really adding a negative 9 to this. So a sub n will equal 17 minus 9n plus 9, distributing from the right, and that will be negative 9n plus 26. So that is my explicit rule for number 69. And the recursive almost writes itself once we know what d is. So the recursive formula, give them a place to start, and then we need to tell them what to add or subtract to the previous term. In this case, we're adding a negative 9, which is like subtracting 9. So a sub n equals a sub n minus 1 minus 9. And again, you know, very nice to have the formulas so that we can just go ahead and write these quickly. And make sure that you're simplifying. Sometimes when you check in the back of the book, this particular book does not simplify your explicit rules occasionally. That's not okay. This is Algebra 2. We are supposed to be master manipulators of letters and numbers, and that means we're always going to simplify. Number 70, we have negative 2, negative 13, and negative 24. So I will go after that explicit rule with the formula that we all have down by now. And a sub n equals negative 2 plus n minus 1, and then we take a look from negative 2 to negative 13, that would be a negative 11. From negative 13 to negative 24, that's also a negative 11. So that's our common difference. And then go ahead and distribute from the left, keeping careful track of that negative as you go through there. So a sub n will equal a negative 11n plus 9. And again, we see that pattern with arithmetic sequences, that we usually have some number times n and then a plus or minus behind it so that we can recognize those types of formulas, those arithmetic formulas, when we get to the end of this chapter. So this is my explicit rule. And the recursive, first term is a negative two. And of course, like I said, we've already found what we were supposed to do. We have to subtract 11. So a sub n equals a sub n minus 1 minus 11. Or you could certainly write it as negative 11 plus a sub n minus 1. But recursive using that previous term. Then I thought, I guess just for fun more than anything, I'd go through 71 and 74. These were using the rules that we had talked about in chapter 6, and at the time, you know, they were probably pretty challenging. So with 71, even before I start doing this problem, I'm thinking about perfect squares that will go into 98. And 49 comes to mind right away. So what that does is that gives me a place to start once I multiply these square roots together, because I can multiply them together given that they are both square roots. So I have the square root of 686. And like I said, I noticed that 49, so I'm going to go ahead and separate this into the square root of 49, and then 49 goes into 686 14 times. And that allows me to know that I did pick the largest perfect square, because there aren't any perfect squares that are going to divide into 14 evenly. And then, of course, I simplify that square root of 49 as a perfect square, so that will be 7 square roots of 14. Now I'm going to go ahead and look at 72. First thing I do is see, is there anything I can simplify before this, inside this, before I get too far? And what I notice is that the 6 and the 2 are both underneath the square root. So I'm going to go ahead and write this as 3/7 and then 1 square root of 6 over 2x. Now the reason that I did that was because now I can do a little canceling, and this will be the square root of 3 over the square root of x. So the smaller, the simpler I can make my radical in my denominator, that's what I want to do. So now my problem is I have a radical in the denominator. To get rid of that square root of x, I need to make my index match my power, which would mean, since this is an index of 2, I need it to be x squared. So I multiply the top and the bottom of this fraction by the square root of x, and I get 3 square roots of 3x, because again, you can multiply square roots times other square roots, and then 7 square roots of x squared. But the square root of x squared is, of course, x. And that means we are done, because there is nothing that we can simplify in the numerator, and we did get rid of the radical in the denominator. So those are just really good practice. We haven't done those in a little bit, so that's a really good review problem. Number 73 brings up that same point where what you want to do first is put these two together in one fraction, because then you'll see that there is some simplifying that we can do underneath that radical symbol, because of course 6 divided by 6 is just 1. And then we have x to the fourth and x squared, and when you divide similar bases, you subtract the exponents. And then y to the first, y to the third, 1 minus 3 would be a negative 2, so what I'm going to do is go ahead and put that in the denominator, because negative powers are for reciprocals. So I have this, and that's really the square root of x squared over the square root of y squared, which is just going to be x over y. And now I would go back and investigate, do I need any absolute value bars anywhere in this solution? Well, you can see that the x's up there had to be positive values, because they had them to the fourth power and to the second power. So I'm going to need absolute value bars for that x. The y values, however, they had a y to the first and a y to the third, so there were going to be some situations where that y could cause a negative answer. So technically, I would not need the absolute value bars on the x, because depending on what y is, this might be a negative answer anyway. So we could just drop that and leave it x over y. All right, number 74. Again, I'm kind of investigating the numbers while I'm writing this problem down. We have the cubed root of 5 and the cubed root of 150. So my first thought is cubed roots. I'll bet you when I get done, I'll be able to use that cubed root of 125. So we're going to take 5 times 150, because these are both cubed roots, and we'll get 750. And then if we divide that by 125, sure enough, it gives us 6. So this is the cubed root of a perfect cube, which is 125, and 6. So I start looking at that cube root of 6 and thinking, are there any perfect cubes that are going to divide into that evenly? And the answer is no, because our first usable perfect cubed with whole numbers is going to be 8, 2 times 2 times 2, so not going to happen. Cubed root of 125 is 5. 5 cubed roots of 6. Then, number 79 says write a recursive formula for each sequence. So as I look at these numbers, I'm thinking they're going up. Is this something really nice, like just some basic additions? So 1 plus 2 is 3, 3 plus 3 is 6, 6 plus 4 is 10. So I have a couple of different things in mind, but they have to do with looking at this problem in a table and saying, all right, what can I do here, you know? So as I look at these, I'm trying to figure out my recursive formula, and I think, all right, my first term is 1. Now, what could I do in this table to generate 1, 3, 6, and 10? And your eyes naturally gravitate to this. 1 plus 2 is 3. 3 plus 3 is 6. 6 plus 4 is 10. So you think, all right, what am I really doing here? What I'm doing is I'm taking the previous term and I'm adding the number of the term that I want. So a sub n equals a sub n minus 1 plus n. Number 81, I'm checking for simple addition. There's 4, there's 9, there's 16. Aha! This has to do with squaring something. So again, I make a table so that I can figure out, is it going to be n squared? Is it going to be n plus 1 squared? What should I really use to do this problem? And I notice if I need this term plus 2 squared, that would give me 5. And if I take 5 plus the 3 squared, I will get 14. So my first term was a 1, and to find any term, what we're going to have to do is use the previous term, but we're going to add n squared. So very similar to number 79, but what we have to notice is the change in that pattern as we go through that. That is all of them for this section.